Good afternoon, everyone. This is Brother Lloyd. And to those who are keeping the Sabbath today, I hope you're having a blessed Sabbath. Now, today we're going to spend a few minutes talking about slavery. Not Alex Haley and Kunta Kinte. We're talking about the slavery of the world that's been around since the beginning of time. So, we're going to go straight into it. Simply put, understand what the simple definition of a slave is as hindered by the Hebrew and Greek. A slave is nothing more than a servant. A bondman or a bond servant. A slave is a servant. Now, thinking like the world makes it difficult, at best, if not impossible, to think like the Father wants us to think. He wants us to think in a particular way, but the world interferes with that through its influence. See, we can be so influenced by the world that we pick up on the world's pattern rather than picking up on the pattern that the Father desires for us. So, what the world and the Father say can be in total contradiction with one another. Go with me to Matthew 20. Matthew 20, we're going to read verses 20 through 28. Verse 20 reads, it says, "Then came him the mother of Zebedee's children with her sons, worshipping him and desiring a certain thing of him. And he said unto her, What wilt thou? She said unto him, Grant that these my two sons may sit the one on the right hand and the other on the left in thy kingdom. But Jesus answered and said, Ye know not what ye ask. Are ye able to drink of the cup that I drink of, and be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with? They say unto him, We are able. And he saith unto them, Ye shall drink indeed of my cup, and be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with. But to sit on my right hand and on my left hand is not mine to give, but it shall be given to them for whom is prepared of my Father." So, first question, who were her two sons? Well, if you look at Matthew 4:21, it tells us that her two sons were James and John, and we know they did drink of the Savior's cup. Next, let's move on. Now, the world views great men as those who exercise authority and power over people. Those with prominence, power, position, money, etc., or those viewed great. So Matthew 20:25 continues on saying this, "But Jesus called them unto him and said, Ye know that the princes of the Gentiles exercise dominion over them, and they that are great exercise authority upon them. But it shall not be so among you. But whosoever will be great among you, let him be your minister," or "let him be your servant." A minister is a servant. Minister means to serve. And when he says, "But it shall not be so among you," who's he speaking of? He's speaking about believers. Verse 27 says, "And whosoever will be chief among you, let him be your servant." Verse 28, "Even as the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister, and to give his life a ransom for many." Why would he come to give his life for many as a ransom? Well, because we've all been kidnapped by what? Sin. We are all prisoners of sin. So he is simply saying that any one of us who wants to be great has to be a servant or slave, as he has shown us by his example. See, we don't typically think of Yeshua as a servant or slave with our first thoughts. That's because you think of what? Lord, Savior, Master, or God when you think of him or the Father. See, he saw himself as a servant to his Father and to mankind, even though he was still all the things that I just mentioned. Scripture teaches this. Go with me to Colossians 1, and we're going to go to verses 15 through 18. Verse 15 reads, it says, "Who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature." 16, "For by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by him and for him." Verse 17, "And he is before all things, and by him all things consist." 18, "And he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have preeminence. See, Paul calls him the creator, sustainer of all things created, and the head of the church. And this is how we view him. And even Revelation 19:16 says that he is what? The King of Kings. This is in part why we view him the way we do and not as a servant. See, he understood that he came into this world as a servant to serve us and his Father. This goes back to what? Matthew 10:26, which read, "But it shall not be so among you, but whosoever will be great among you, let him be your minister," or let him be your servant. So even though he was a servant, we have to understand how great he was in his servitude. Now, the greatest expression of this servitude was what? Was the cross. He gave his life on the cross as a ransom for our freedom. This is what the cross is all about, people. Understand what the cross is all about. He paid the price for all our sins. This is what redeemed us. This is what he did to allow us the opportunity so that we can have eternal life and life more abundantly while we're here. So without the doctrine of the cross, because that's what it's about, without that doctrine, we have nothing. There's no salvation, there's no redemption, and there is no forgiveness for our sins. So he came to serve us to eliminate that so we will have the opportunity. So what is a ransom? A ransom is a price paid, what? To set a slave free. Anybody being held by something against their will, they're a slave. So he came to pay the price for us, which was his life on the cross, and that is what set us free. He was our redeemer and our liberator. See, but people will say, well, I'm not a slave who needs to be free to follow him, and that's true. If you're not a slave who set free to follow him, you're still a slave. Go with me to Romans 6:16-18. Now, verse 16 reads, it says, "Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness." 17. "But God be thanked that ye were servants of sin, but ye have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered you." Remember the doctrine I just talked about, the cross, that doctrine. "Being then made free from sin, ye became the servants of righteousness." See, verse 17, like I just said, talks about that form of doctrine. And we know that's the doctrine of the cross. And without that, we still be slaves to sin. And we die in that. But Hebrews 10:23, as a reference, reads, "Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised." And this takes us to Hebrews 4:14, which reads, "Seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession." So we're talking about the doctrine of Yeshua, Jesus, our Savior. See, without this doctrine, we would still be slaves. But let's go back for a second to those who think they're free, even if they don't accept the doctrine of the cross. See, they'll say that they do what they want to do, or they choose to do what they want to do that pleases them. And to that I say, you're wrong. Simply put, what you're doing is catering to what your flesh or your humanness has dictated to you and what Satan has engineered in your life through what? Thoughts and temptation. Now, this doesn't mean that anyone who does this is all evil. See, you can and could have still done good things in your life, but you still can't serve two masters, as we're told in Luke 16:31. You either serve Satan and the flesh, or you serve the Father and the Holy Spirit. Romans 6:20 says this, "For when ye were servants of sin, ye were free from righteousness." So as long as you are a servant to sin, you're a slave to that sin. Or before we chose to put our trust in him and become saved, we were slaves to sin because what? It kept us from righteousness. But still, many think that they are doing what they choose to do. Example, you may have started taking drugs or using drugs because you enjoyed them. But the question gets to be now, why can't you get off them if you're in control and doing what you want to do? Another example, you may have started drinking because you enjoyed it, but now you're an alcoholic, but why don't you quit and never drink again? See, the problem is you become enslaved to sin without thinking about it. But because so many things offer such a beautiful picture of freedom and enjoyment, you fail to realize that you have become a slave to it. See, you really believe that you have chosen the very thing or things that have enslaved you. Thus, you're a slave without the knowledge of realizing that you're a slave, because you can't get away from it even if you want to. You just struggle with it going back and forth. Every form of sin enslaves us by its very nature. So when Yeshua says he came to set the captives free, as in Luke 4:18, it was to free us from the power of sin in our life and the power it has over us. This is why he says he came to give his life a ransom for many. He also came to give us the blessing that comes with what? This abundant life. John 10:10 reads, it says, I come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. See, the ultimate expression of Yeshua's servitude was the cross. See, we can't get away from that. That was the ultimate thing. Remember, he said, I came to give my life for the many. So the question is, who's that many? Well, go with me to Titus 2:11. It reads, it says, for the grace of God that bringeth salvation have appeared to all men. Romans 5:15 follows and says, but not as the offense, so also is the free gift, salvation that is, for if through the offense of one many be dead, dead to what? Dead to sin, much more of the grace of God and the gift by grace, which by one man, Yeshua, hath abounded unto many. And Luke 6 reads, and all flesh shall see the salvation of God. 1 John 2:1-2 tells us, my little children, these things write I unto you, that ye sin not. And if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. Verse 2, and he is the propitiation of our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world. So what does this mean? Well, to propitiate means to win or regain favor of the Father by doing what pleases him. So what did his son do? Remember the doctrine of the cross. I talked about that earlier. He gave himself as the ultimate sacrifice for mankind on Calvary to do what? To win favor with the Father for the whole world. And then finally, Isaiah 53:11 reads like this. It says, he shall see the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bare the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. See, remember, all the sin of the world was laid upon him, and he took it to the cross for all of mankind's sake. He was treated as a transgressor, and he bore the sins of the world in doing so. Understand that the plan of salvation was made to save us, while at the same time preventing those who would never concede their heart to the will of the Father a way to bring sin into heaven. Although many throughout history will be in this group, the plan of salvation was designed to prevent Satan and his fallen angels or demons from ever having a right to enter into heaven again. So it wasn't designed to keep all of us out, but many of mankind are going to fall because they were not relinquishing their heart to the will of the Father. So that's another study lesson. And with that being said, remember, the Heavenly Father doesn't call on us to be successful. He calls on us to be faithful. This is 2 of 8, 7. I'm out.